So thank you very much for coming along and agreeing to give the talk.
Well, thank you for inviting me and having me over. As we just said, right? I think this is really important to have these cross-fertilization among the different communities. Let me just get this little picture out of the way. And so we just talked about CP and SAT and ASP. And if you like, what really makes ASP different is the possibility to work with closed world reasoning. I think that's the, if you want to nail it down to a point, there are techniques of CP, there are techniques of SAT in ASP, but what really makes it different is that you can have, that you have closed world reasoning. And this means you can have defaults, you can have transitive closure and these type of things. Anyway, as also mentioned in the introductory blah, blah, we did a little bit to chat up, was that I decided to give a pretty shallow talk here to, well, to give you a little bit of overview and to simplify things here and there a little bit, just to give you the intuition. Also, what I will be doing, and I will not be doing this out of advertisement, I will sometimes be talking actually about also what we do in our startup, simply because this somewhat gives, at least it's for me, a very valuable thing, because you suddenly talk to people completely outside of our communities and how they actually feel about things. So actually, Potasco, we have these two websites, is potasco.org is where all our software is bundled, and potasco.com is where the company is residing. But let's get started. So this is more or less the outline. As I said, it's going to be pretty shallow. And of course, I will start motivating things. So, and again, I think what I will show you now is something I think we all have in common. Hence, I will go through this a little bit faster and just point to certain things in the end, actually, that will be where I think we are a little bit thinking about the different outcome of the whole solving enterprise. So traditional software, we all know, right? We have users, they execute programs, they execute this on a computer. And what they are doing is problem solving. And well, again, in our community, that's all, that these are all truisms. What happens is, a programmer writes a program, and he actually, what a program is more or less, is it's a description of a path to a solution, right? So the intelligence relies with the programmer. Now the and what is this described in this path to a solution is how to solve the problem. And now if you think about knowledge driven software, that's actually the term I like to use, also in view of the outside world, right? How to explain actually what we are doing. Is you have another abstraction layer, you have a solver. And this solver is actually the guy that takes the burden of finding the path to the solution, because it knows generically how to do that. And then of course there are some different placements in that. And again, this is what we all have in common, nothing new. So in the same way as we describe here how a problem is solved, and this is application or domain specific, we have here the domain specific part is here the what part, where we only describe what the problem is. And with the exclamation mark here with the how, I would like to stress that this is a generic thing, just as with the computer. In the same way that the computer can compute all computable functions, our solvers can compute, let's say, all combinatorial search and optimization problems, right? And then, of course, the crucial part is above here, that we more or less, at this point here, we abolish programming. We only want to declare what our problem is, like when you have a board game where you have instructions of how to play the game, but the solver is playing the game in the end. So that's the idea, and I think we all share that. So one thing that where it starts a bit, I think, to become different is actually where we come from. So you know, ASP somehow, yes, of course, it emerged as a semantics of logic programming, but it was really developed in the community in the area of knowledge representation and reasoning as a subfield of AI. Look at SAT, for instance, who had their killer application in computer aided verification, which is very much influenced by where the killer application is, where some of the original application domain was. Here, the idea is really that what you describe here is knowledge. Hence, you also have some ideas on how you want to represent knowledge. So of course, this is all a logic-based formalism, and I think that's pretty clear. But also there are these ideas tracing back to John McCarthy, is what constitutes a knowledge representation language. And one of the criteria he put forward was elaboration tolerance, with the idea is whenever there's a small change in the real world, this should be reflected by a small change in the representation of the real world. And normally what where you get this very nicely is, for instance, if you represent things just by facts, right? You don't actually directly encode things by let's say already by constraints. No, you just use facts, and then from these facts you instantiate your constraints, and that's actually very elaboration tolerant. But these are actually principles that are important to people in ASP as a part of the community of knowledge representation and reason. And the other thing here is also that the idea that you have an expert here aims at the situation that this person is not necessarily an ASP guy, or not even a computer scientist. It's someone who really is a domain expert, and I will come to this a little bit later. And this is actually also something we actually push a lot in our commercial enterprise. Okay, so this is I think this picture is we can all share this picture. It's just perhaps here these two items here where perhaps we have a different approach, different principles we strive for. Good. So what's the benefit of this? I think, again, we all know that, right? The expert formulates his or her knowledge. And then what you get is it's transparent, it's flexible, it's maintainable. I think all these things are nothing new to you guys. But it's, again, this thing that if the expert formulates the knowledge, then you can actually, what you want to take this even one level higher, right? So, and that actually the knowledge is formulated in natural language. And that it's actually a layperson that can do that. And actually, as many good things, it's down over in Oz, right? Rolf Schwitter at Macquarie University in Sydney, he actually works a lot on these natural language interfaces that compile controlled natural language into ASP and back, right? And that's pretty cool because let's say you described a shift banning system. In for a company, and the union wants to know what the shift banning system is doing. Well, then you can compile this back into a text. They can more or less, they can read it, and or perhaps there are alternatives, different constraint settings. They are compiled back into natural language, and then the layperson, people that have no computer science training at all, can actually look at this. This is, I think, the highest level that one can come up with. To be honest, we are not doing this. Rolf is did a lot of nice work in as I said, in Sydney. But so far, actually, nobody pays for that. So, and of course, academically, we're not natural language experts. We're not doing this ourselves. But I guess that's actually where we should really be heading. And of course, all with this discussion of transparency, I think we are all, and I mean we, ASP, CP, SAT, are all in a setting where we can actually make things nice and transparent because we have a syntax. Good, then. That's perhaps the other thing. So again, as I was saying, I wanted to give a little bit, how do people in industry reflect on ASP? And the interesting thing, we heard this from a couple of customers, right? We develop encodings, which are sets of constraints, sets of rules, right? And this is actually handed over to the customer that can run them by themselves because our systems are open source. And what is the model is the company get our open source solvers. We or other companies give them an encoding, and then they can work with this encoding. And the first thing is feedback we got independently is to say, oh, we didn't know how you came up with these rules here, these constraints or whatever, but I can understand that. This is my knowledge. And so what we also do for larger companies, when one I can, we work for Swiss Railway. They actually, before Corona, actually, we were giving workshops, and we are trying to introduce ASP as a technology just in the same way as Java or whatever you use, right? That people, and the interesting in these courses, there is perhaps a third computer scientist, but there are business people there, people with completely different training. And that's a bit the idea. That's actually what we are striving for. Okay, good. So that's a bit just to pinpoint a bit the differences, perhaps what experiences we made and how we approach things. Of course, for the solver, again, it's not a big deal. It's more or less the same if you have an ASP solver, a SAT solver, or a CP solver, right? They're general. They can solve all types of problems. They're very effective nowadays. They can evaluate objective functions in different ways, and they're freely available, right? So that's more or less the motivation of things. That's how we sit. Okay, let's now talk a bit about ASP. So ASP is, of course, such an approach for declarative problem solving. And more or less it has, I'd say four mothers, right? So database, deductive databases, data log, logic programming, of course, knowledge representation and reasoning. And here in the reasoning part, one should particularly think about non-monotonic reasoning, right? And satisfiability solving as more or less, I think we all owe a lot of the folks in SAT simply because they really optimized this technology a lot and we got a lot of many ideas from them. Good. One thing that is perhaps interesting to look at these four is if you look at the first three, database, logic programming, non-monotonic reasoning, they all operate under the closed world assumption, right? So the idea is that you formulate your knowledge and whenever you leave something blank, something undefined, it's assumed to be false or you have a default for it or whatever. This is of course different in SAT where things are monotonic, where you cannot specify defaults. And this is, I think, again, the main difference of ASP with all different, with the other approaches like CP, like SAT, right? It's this closed world reasoning thingy that you may or may not do. In ASP, you have the choice, right? Good, so there it comes from. And in a way, the first take home message is more or less that ASP is a combination of these fields. And actually in particular, the database thingy, this is actually the technology that underlies the so-called grounders. These are the guys who take a first order specification and systematically replace all object variables by terms so that you get a propositional representation. That's actually where a lot of database technology goes in. Logic programming, this where the origins come from, knowledge representation, non-monotonic reasoning, of course, I'll come to that, where a lot of influences on the semantics came in. And I think the engines are just based on SAT technology. Even though these are not ASP solvers, 10% of an ASP solver is a SAT solver, but it's not just a SAT solver. Okay, so what you can do, again, same as you can do in CP or SAT, you can solve a combinatorial optimization problems. But my argument is, again, I think ASP is particularly suited for knowledge-intense problems. So if you have to if you have a lot of knowledge that you want to formulate, I think ASP is a good choice for that. So what problems are these? We all know we have to take many decisions under constraints. And here are the typical examples, right? And I don't have to go into that too much. Let me just look a little bit at some applications of ASP, for instance, in industry. Here, just selected some. So those of you who use Debian and Ubuntu may actually use our solver for the software configuration part, not as a default, but it's one option in these systems. That I think the first, you know, in ASP, you can't speak of a killer application like in SAT, where they really went into computer-aided verification and made a big bang. There are just a lot of applications popping up. I think the first one that really helped us a lot to boost the thing was Michael Gelfond's group in at Texas Tech, which implemented a decision support system for the space shuttle at NASA, which of course helped us a lot to promote ASP. Well, but then of course they stopped the space shuttle and this application went away. One thing that I find interesting, and it speaks, I think, also for the robustness of the systems we develop, is some of you may remember that 2 or 3 years ago there was the auction on the radio for radio frequencies from radio stations and mobile communication that was run by the US government. Actually, the US government hired a company that did it, and they actually had a revenue of roughly $20 billion, right? And this auction was controlled by a solver. And actually, it was a solver portfolio consisting of two solvers. One was actually, I think, Suttonstein. It's the local search solver of UBC, of Kevin Leighton Brown and Holger Hoos, and the other was actually Clasp, which is actually an ASP solver, but it was used as a SAT solver because they were the most effective ones on this subject. I think with Clasp, it's one thing that I think Clasp is one of the highest configurable solvers, whether you use it for ASP, SAT, PP solving, whatever, it can do all that. But there are all these options around. And of course, with the background of Kevin Leighton Brown, they of course wanted to, they took the solvers off the shelf, then they configured them for the problem. And after the configuration, Clasp actually was by far the most robust and fastest one. So, but what this shows actually is rather that ASP solvers have also obtained a certain robustness, because actually I just learned about this afterwards, that they were using our solver for that. And that's of course I didn't see a single cent of it, but already being able to talk about it is just is just great, right? Okay. Anyway, so you see that ASP also has quite some impact in industry, and this is taking up more and more, I'd say.
But I have a question for you.
Yes.
But while we're on this topic, so can you, about these applications, do you think these applications are very specific to ASP that could not be handled with, for example, SAT or CP?
No.
So for instance, what's the special ingredient that ASP brings to the table?
Again, here for this FCC application, they use it as a SAT service. It was more or less, it boiled down to a graph problem, right? There was no, they actually used they really used it as a SAT solver. I think we did the Linux configuration there already. I think it was interesting that you could just write down things on a high level language and have different language constructs for things. So it's, I think a good example, which is not here on this, is perhaps workforce management. Is if you do shift planning or timetabling or whatever, because the language of ASP, which I will show you in a few slides, allows you to formulate cardinality and weight constraints in a very simple way, and you can really nicely write things down. At the end of the day, right? You can also have a specification in CP or even in SAT for that, right? But the systems are perhaps not, let's say, I wouldn't say tuned. They cannot accommodate such constraints perhaps in such a direct way, because you first have to compile them into it. I think another difference is which again is perhaps not on these applications here, is chip design. So we are actually doing design space exploration, so synthesizing hardware layout from specifications, and their reachability is a big thing. And one of the effects of having closed world reasoning is that you can write down transitive closure. Right, and there, this is, for instance, a difference which you can natively write in ASP, where you have to do some encoding to get this. But on these applications, otherwise, I think in principle, you can do that as well with another solver.
And do you use is ASP? From my understanding, ASP would be more expressive than, let's say, SAT. And I'm just curious,
Well, expressive. The thing is, I think it's. Expressive. Pardon me?
Can it go beyond NP?
Yeah, you can go up to the second level if you want. The thing is, if you just take a propositional, a Boolean formula, right? An arbitrary Boolean formula, then deciding whether this formula has a Boolean model is NP, as we all know, but deciding whether it has a stable model is sigma pi complete, right? So we go one level higher. But normally in ASP, you use a logic programs, normal logic programs, where you don't go to that level. Mm-hmm. So you also stay at NP.
Also for these applications, mostly they would be still stay in the NP level, not go into the, let's say, second level.
Mostly, yes. At least with these ones looking, yes, because I think where you really go to the second level from time to time is when you want to do fancy optimization. So for instance, the optimization that is happening here is mainly a cost function, and there you go to where you have a polynomial of calls to an NP oracle that doesn't, but if you want to have a more sophisticated optimization function like a subset or Pareto or whatever, right, then you go to the second level.
Okay, thanks. I'm just asking because I'm interested, and probably many people here, what can we take away from ESP and include in our systems?
Yeah, I think I'll still get to this a bit later, right? So,
okay, thank you.
Good. Oh, you're very welcome. Okay, so what I say are the distinguishing features of ASP? First of all, it has this high level versatile modeling language, and I think this is really a difference, because you more or less formulate things in terms of rules, high-level constraints. You don't have computer science things. You don't have for loops or other things. You just write it down in a rule-based fashion, right? And this is at least it seems to be understandable by non-computer scientists. That's actually one of the, and of course this modeling language unlike SAT, is a first order language, even though the variables only range over a finite domain. The domain can be infinite, but the result of grounding must be finite, right? Then, of course, the common thing is with SAT and CP are high performance servers. But yet another thing that I think is very nice about ASP, you can have qualitative and quantitative optimization. So we have, for instance, this Aspirin system where you can say, oh, I want Pareto of a sum of minimization, maximization, and another subset thing. And you just write down a formula that describes an expression over qualitative and quantitative optimization. And there actually you could use some second order some second level. You need some second level expressiveness. Good. So, and there are now the first companies, or the guys in Calabria, the DLV people, have DLV systems since quite a while, and we have now Potasco solutions since, I don't know, 2-3 years or so. And but the interest is mainly with large companies. So we have a hard time actually selling to small or middle-sized companies, but with large companies we get along very well, because I think they can see the impact on in the long run. Okay, now let me briefly go over the evolution, because I think there are also some differences may pop up. So this is again my very biased way to describe a little bit how the development of ASP happened. So I think in the 80s, of course, there was this idea of how can we actually capture incomplete information. It was in databases, and I think with Keith Clark's completion, he captured the closed world assumption databases, logic programming, negation as failure, normal dynamic reasoning. They came up with very different ways, auto epistemic logic, default logic, circumscription. And so this was more or less a finding. There were whole zoos of different semantics, right? And that was, let's say, a bit of a struggle, because everybody had its own approach and then argued. And it was more or less in the 90s where things started to converge. And then actually the logic programming semantics were mainly influenced, stable models, in particular stable model semantics, by non-monotonic reasoning. Because at the time, there were three different papers. The first actually who published stable model semantics were French. It was Catherine Froidevaux and Nicole Bidois. And they actually derived it from default logic. Then Michael Gelfond and Vladimir Lifshitz came slightly later, I think also because their paper had gotten rejected first. They derived it from auto-epistemic logic. And there is a third proposal in philosophy by, I think, a person called Klein. Vladimir told me this, which also proposed this at the same time. It happened in philosophy. And I just learned about it, I think, a year ago or so. So, and then more or less there was this well-founded semantics, which is a polynomial semantics, and stable model semantics. And ASP solving can be actually understood as you compute the well-founded semantics, perhaps a bit more, perhaps a bit less. And this is more or less the strength of the propagation. And then you branch, right? A little bit like in the Davis Putnam, right? Where you propagate and then you branch, and this gives you stable models. So this is also the relation between these two semantics. And again, the stable model semantics, that's what I found interesting, really came more from non-monotonic reasoning than from logic programming as such. Then there was in the beginning of this millennia, there was of course a growing dissemination, and we've seen that. But I think the major breakthrough, to be honest, it also took me years to appreciate that, was that David Pearce at the time more or less rediscovered that the logical foundations of ASP go back to constructive logics, a logic developed by Heiting in the 30s and Gödel. So Heiting had this logic of here and there. It's a Kripke structure with two worlds, a here world and a there world, where more or less from the here world you see the there world. And this amounts to Gödel's logic G3. And he more or less then did a logical reconstruction of ASP, which are now the logical foundations of ASP. Because everything that happened here before was meta-mathematics, right? So you have the reduct, some of you have seen, and I will show you this in a sec, right? And you do all types of meta-mathematics, but this is now a logic. It's a logic of here and there, and then you have some minimization on top to get the stable models. So, and this was a big breakthrough. Everything we do nowadays with extending this, right? So one thing that you may find interesting, and I think presumably nobody in your community knows about that, we have this HTC logic. It's the semantics for non-monotonic constraint satisfaction problems, that you can have actually variables in CS, you have a CSP problem, right? And the variables are treated non-monotonically. What you have to do in this logical setting. Okay, good. So anyway, so I will not really go into that today because it gets rather technical, but this, I think, was one of the major breakthroughs there. And then I think nowadays, again, we are more or less, it's about integration. It's, I think, the same thing that happened in SAT, right? And in CP presumably as well, right? You have SAT, it's great, but then you want to go applications and you need different constraints. So there is the birth of SMT, right? SAT modulo theorems. The same happened in automated theorem proving, right? Where you had theorem provers, you needed to include other or inject other constraints. Same is happening in ASP now. Good. So let's briefly look at foundations. I have to watch my time as well. So the foundation that I will be giving you will be really simplified, but I want to just to point out certain things. And if you really want to know what foundations they are, I think Vadim Milivojevic has a paper that keeps changing its title. I think recently it was called 13 Alternative Definitions of Stable Model Semantics, and I think it's still growing. Okay, so let's now look at the easy part, right? So this is more or less, we just look at propositional rules. So this is a standard rule. We have here the head and here we have the body. These are all letters are atoms, and then the commas are is a conjunction, and here there is negation, right? And the intuitive reading is the head must be true if the body holds. And actually, if you, what I was already saying, that for instance, people derive stable model semantics from default logic, this is actually not a classical implication. It's more like an inference rule, because you cannot do modus ponens, you cannot do reasoning by cases with it, right? It's really more like an inference rule. And actually, this is nicely reflected by this logic of here and there, because this logic of here and there is a constructive logic. It's actually an intermediate logic sitting between intuitionistic and classical logic, but the implication is constructive. Okay, so
can you tell us a little bit more about that? Because it looks like an implication, like if B1 is true,
yeah, it's, no, no, but the,
then look, the head will be true. So it's like, what yeah. is the difference here?
The syntax is that of classical logic, right? It's the same as the syntax of classical logic. It's the same as intuitionistic logic. It's just that you have a different ways of interpreting the connectives. Mm-hmm. But again, I cannot really talk about mm-hmm. this logic too much, because we will then I would need a whole tutorial like this to talk about this mm-hmm. logic on crypt key structures and all that. Let me stack this question until we've been through this section, and perhaps then.
Okay great. Thanks.
No worries. You are very welcome. So the semantics of such programs, right? If you have a set of such guys, is given by the stable models, and they are more or less classical Boolean models, with the exception that everything that is true in these models must have a proof, and a proof in the sense of a chain of implications that allow you to derive from the facts this atom, right? At least from the positive part, right? That's the idea. And now, again, logically, you can do this in this logical framework. The original definition worked with a reduct, and I think this also nicely has some things to show. I will do that now, right? So we will just look at now, how does this work that all the atoms in such a model are justified, I have a proof. Okay, so here's a little disclaimer, let's go on. So back to our undergraduate days. So truth tabling. And now if I say back to SAT, I actually mean Boolean propositional logic. I just wanted to have a short name to say that, right? So we know how to work with propositional logic. We have here 8 interpretations for the 3 variables ABC. And here we have a formula that we want to evaluate. And the way we do this in a classical system, where we take all the values for the variables, we substitute them here, and then we evaluate, right? So we evaluate first, the classical negation here, these guys. And then we look at the implication and evaluate. So these guys are false, so they are replaced by false. Then we these guys are true, we replace them by true. Then we evaluate the conjunction, and here we go. We then, at the end, after evaluating the formula in each of the 8 interpretations, 4 of them yield true, and these are the green guys here, and they are then called the propositional models. Okay, now if one now takes this principle and looks what is happening in stable model semantics, and this is actually close to the original definition of Lifshitz and Gelfond in the end of the 80s, Almost the same thing happened, just that you only evaluate the negative part. Let's look at this. So, okay, so sorry, I was a bit too fast. So I will abbreviate these FIFO interpretations normally in the set notation, but I think this is pretty standard, so I don't have to explain that any further. So let's do the same thing now in ASP. Now, what you do in ASP, you also evaluate the formulas, but only the negative part. Because again, for the positive part, you don't say, oh, I don't rely on what is here in the interpretation. I want to construct a proof. Okay, so how does that happen? So we now only, whenever there is a negated formula like here, this is what we treat classically. So everything behind a negation is treated classically. So we just here insert. So there's only a negated part here. And again, this is very simplified now for normal logic programs. We only substitute here the value. Then we do the same thing again. We evaluate and we evaluate and we evaluate and we get what is called a reduct. And now this reduct will be used to see whether we can prove actually what was claimed in the interpretation to be true. So here we had these, and let's just look at these four models, because for the others we already know that there will be no stable models, because stable models are a subset of the classical models. So for these guys, we now check. Now we look, what can we prove from them? So from B and C, which atoms can we prove? Actually none, right? So because there are no facts. So here actually from the second interpretation, A is true, so of course we can prove A. Same thing here, A is true, we can prove A, and here we can also prove nothing. So more or less, if we then look at what the interpretation promised here, we see that here, this interpretation promised that B is true and C is true, but they're not provably true. We cannot find a proof for them. The only interpretation that more or less holds its promise in the sense it's claimed that something is true, but then actually everything is provable is actually this guy here. And this is also the only stable model. And this is actually one of the reasons why Vladimir and Michael called this a stable model, because they wanted to say it's a model that is stable under rule application. So not only closed, but also that things are, everything really has a proof in such a setting, right? And so among the four models, we here get one stable model, and here things must not only be true, but provably true. Actually, just as a side remark from the logical point of view, those of you who have a logical training may actually know that in intrinsic logic, there are also not only two literals. So here as well in ASP, you have three basic literals. You have a proposition, a single negated proposition, and a double negated proposition. And just a proposition must be provably true. It's not only enough that it's true, there must also be a proof for it. Whenever there is a negation, things are treated classically. So single negation is just negation, just in another logic. And double negation means you just treat it like in classical logic, you can just do a guess. You can look in the guessed interpretation and say, oh, I have this truth value, I accept it, right? That's the difference. So it's the double negated atom is just true. And a non-negated atom, a positive literal, must be provably true. And again, this is just intuition hand-waving. I cannot make this very precise. Believe me. So more or less then the stable models are the smallest models of the respective reduct. That's more or less the idea. Good. So if you then compare stable model semantics with Boolean semantics, you can say that actually SAT is ASP, and you then add the law of the excluded middle. So if for each proposition you add A, each proposition A, you add A or not A, then you end up with SAT. So adding this A or not A, which is not a tautology in ASP, takes you back to Boolean logic. So what you see then, and on the other hand, if you want to axiomatize ASP and SAT, you have to do much more work. You have to add the completion formula, which more or less because we talk about implication and completion roughly, then adds the other direction and loop formulas. And the loop formulas are the nasty guys, because there you want to forbid all circular proofs. And there may be exponentially many circular structures. And so this actually is reflected in the result that if you want to compile ASP into SAT and you do not extend the language, you risk an exponential blow up. But if you compile SAT into ASP, it can be done in linear and actually in, even in a modular way. So ASP has this edge, and it shows if you look at language preserving translations. So of course, the basic decision problem is in both cases, because I just looked at normal logic problem, is NP. So if you introduce auxiliary variables, you can translate them back and forth, right? That's not a deal. But you cannot. There is, for instance, no modular translation of ASP into SAT, while SAT in ASP you can do modular, because it's a simpler approach. Just to let you know, those of you who ever came across ASP, this law of the extruded middle, and I'm now here at the bottom of the screen, right, is when you model in ASP encoding, you just write this choice rule. And this way you can have atoms that are under the open world assumption. So if you write this, A will be treated as in a Boolean classical monotonic setting. And if you don't declare an atom like this, then it will be treated under the closed world assumption. So again, I was just looking at the easy part of normal logic programs. But in general, if you have, as I mentioned at the beginning, if you have a Boolean formula in propositional logic, checking whether it has a model is NP, while here actually you go to the second level. Good. So now let me come back to the stack question. Did I shed a bit more light on that?
Mm-hmm, okay. I think so. I'm trying to see like what would be the equivalent in constraint programming, for example. But I think we can talk about that maybe later.
Yeah. Here, of course, I made my job easy because I compared two logical approaches, mm-hmm. right? And that's, of course, in CP, that's a bit different. But there we had to, yeah, okay, let's perhaps...
Because mm-hmm. usually the literals are like, let's say, 0, 1. And what happens if we have some integers, for example?
Yes. That would be the equivalent. This is what we did in this paper about HTC at Ichka in Buenos Aires. So I had to look it up, but there actually we gave such a stable model semantics for CSP problems.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Okay, great.
And it gets a bit intricate, but because let's see how much time we have afterwards in the question in the question section. Okay, now. Foundation. Let's see how this is actually working. This is more or less the standard workflow in ASP. You have a problem. You want to get to a solution. So what you do here, you model. And of course, that this guy down here is called logic program is really a bad thing, because of course it's not a program anymore, because the order doesn't matter. It doesn't matter in which you do not express any control anymore. Because the execution of there is no execution anymore. You specify things. It would be so. We often talk about an encoding in that case, and logic program actually is just something from the past. So anyway, so you have here you model your program in terms of rules, and I will come to some language construct in a sec, which is a first order representation. So you have object variables, and again, the cool thing about having that, and now comparing to SAT, is that you have an encoding that should work for all problem instances, right? And then you have a problem, the problem instance as such is then given normally as a file with facts, and you can use this encoding for all different problem instances. In SAT, since you are right away in a propositional setting, that's actually not, that you don't get that. But that's simply because you have a first order modeling language. Good, then actually the grounder actually kicks in, and this grounder is more or less just like a solver, also a box that has a well-specified input and output, which takes actually the first order logic program and systematically replaces all variables by ground terms, so that here at this point we get a propositional logic program. And then this propositional logic program is fed into the solver, which works, you can think of it just like a solver, right? And what you get then are the assignments that correspond to stable models, and then you interpret these guys. And I think one thing that is particular to ASP is that the way back here is very, very short. So if, let's say, if you look at your solution and say, ah, there's a bug or whatever, then looking at, because you have symbols, you have a symbol table, you can look at it, right? You can directly go back to your encoding and try to fix it and try to rectify things. And again, let me just compare it to SAT, because I think this is a particularly, let's say, sparse approach, right? So if you would have take the same diagram here in SAT, you have your problem, and then you have to write yourself a program, Python, C++, Java, whatever, that takes your problem, that does the instance and instantiation more or less on the fly if needed, and directly translate this into Dimax. And so whenever you then have a bug here or a problem, right, you don't go back to an easily modifiable, readable encoding. No, you have to go back in the source code and then play, go into the system or the program that produces the Dimax format, right? You cannot go back to a representation that is easy to modify. And again, I think the SCP also has more to offer than SAT at that point. But that's actually very important. And keep in mind, we are the guys under the umbrella of knowledge representation and reasoning, and this is more or less a must that you have such a nice readable representation that is easily modifiable. So let's look now at some language constructs. So what you have in the very base are you have facts and rules, right? So here you have a fact, and you can always think of a fact as a line in a database, right? So nothing fancy. And here you then have rules, and you have first order variables, and they are indicated by uppercase letters and the comma. And here then in source you write negation via not. And then these guys get instantiated here in this case, taking just these two, this fact and this rule, you would get this here. But keep in mind that in general, actually, whenever you instantiate a rule, instantiating a single rule is already a CSP problem by itself, because you have a combinatorial thing, you may have n or five variables, and all the combinations have to be put in, right? And to finally produce all the ground instances of a rule. And one thing that, just as an anecdote on the side, which always is a bit strange for people, since ASP, the input language of ASP, allows function symbols, just the grounder by itself, that is this little box here, is Turing complete. You can encode a Turing machine here, which is a bit funny, right? Because your solver more or less decides problems and goes up to the second level. But the grounder here, actually, you can encode a Turing machine into it. Yeah, that's always a bit funny, right? But okay, good. So you have these facts and these rules. And then what else is there? One thing that people use a lot when they model are conditional literals. Now let's just look at this, and I think the yellow is just perhaps a bit small, but this is more or less here the conditional literal, and here you see this colon. And now imagine you would have a parenthesis here and a parenthesis here. And I think all of us would directly, oh, that's a set, right? And this is exactly how it is treated. You more or less, where for all the access that satisfy R, you produce an instance of Q. But since this is in the context of a body, this will not remain a set, this will be a conjunction. And this gives you some way of quantifying, of really writing things rather nicely compact. If you do not know right away which objects will all satisfy Q, but these are the guys that satisfy R. So you can do this here in the body in that way, also in the head, and et cetera, et cetera. So that's pretty cute when modeling. Then there is disjunction. And this actually, disjunction is an operator that gives you in the stable model, that leads you in the stable model to the second level of the polynomial hierarchy. That's actually also why the arbitrary formulas at that level, because this disjunction here is neither inclusive nor exclusive, it's minimized. And this is actually where this additional level of complexity comes from, because the idea is, it's always this idea that you have a solution candidate, which one NP oracle gives you, and then the next one has to check that there is no better one, right? And that's also happening here with this minimization. Then there are integrity constraints, and you can view this as a rule that implies falsity. So here actually the head is left blank, but you can think of it as a contradiction. And it says there must not be an X that satisfies both Q and P. Then there are choices. These are non-deterministic, the non-deterministic way to select objects. So for instance, if you do configuration, that comes from pretty handy, right? But here this says, well, the among the you fix here the y, and then you look at all the possible x's that you get for q, and you may afterwards have here, I don't know, 42 ground instances of p, and you are allowed to select, you must select at most, no, at least 2 and at most 7. And you can imagine that the same thing also works with some constraints where you then actually here have a term and you sum over. And then what is also built in is a multi-objective optimization. So it's a bit like these weak constraints that here that you, these guys are more or less, you can violate them, but then you pay a penalty. And this is done in a, so this is multi-objective because you can have different levels here. This is now at level 42, but you can have arbitrary levels also inside by variables. And that's then the penalty that you pay. And this way, more or less, you formulate things. Good, so how much time do I have left actually?
So we have, so depends on how much, so in general, this would be more or less the time that we would have. Now we will have some questions for 15 minutes.
Okay. So,
but we could go a bit.
If you could give me, let's say, 5 minutes, I should be okay.
Okay, that sounds good. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Okay, good. So that's the language. So let me give you an example. So traveling salesperson. I think all of you know traveling salesperson. Right? You have to find a cycle in a graph so that each node is visited exactly once. So we do this here with cities. So we have four cities. This is the city where we start. We start at A, we have four cities and we have rows between them and they have a certain length. Okay, this is the problem instance. Now let me show you the problem encoding in ASP. Now, again, keep in mind that if you want to come up with a solution, you don't know what the solution is. And then of course you have to open this up and then you can freely choose. So for each road, x, when you go from x to y, you can add the edge from going from x to y to the travel. And you can then either do this, select it, add it to the travel or not. That's actually why here you then have this choice, right? You either take an element or you don't take it. Okay, now this gives you a guess. So more or less, if you just look at the first rule, you select certain edges that belong to the extension of the travel predicate. And now you analyze that, you say, if X is my starter, in this case A, and I have selected that I can go from A to somewhere else, then I visited it. And here's the recursive rule. So if I visited X and I selected that I can travel from X to Y here, then I also visited Y. And this means you now actually check your guess. And now you say, it must not be the case that there is a city that I have not been visiting. And keep in mind here, this is more or less you define reachability, and this is just the easiest way to do it, and this works due to the non-monotonicity, due to the closed world assumption, right? Good, and then here in the end you say that there cannot be a city that I traveled out once, right? That there's a city where I went from X to some Y twice or more. In the same way, there cannot be a city that I traveled in twice or more. And that's the traveling salesperson problem. And now you combine this, that's the Hamilton cycle. And now here's the objective function that says, if I travel on a road, I pay this penalty here. That's the idea. And then you combine this here with a problem instance, and then you launch a solver. So in this case, Klingo, you have the encoding, you have the instance, and then by default it does branch and bound. But if you change the option, you can also do unsatisfiable core-based optimization. So it finds the first solution which has a value of 100. Then it looks for a better one. It finds one for 95. Then it looks for a better one, doesn't find one. So this means the last one is the best one. Okay, so this just to give you a flavor of that. And again, ASP solvers, they come from knowledge representation and reasoning. So it's not just about satisfiability checking. You can do enumeration. And I think ASP solvers were the first that had CDCL algorithms for enumeration without solution recording. I think we have an old paper at CPIOR where we actually describe that. Then projection. Because often enough, you don't want to enumerate solutions on the whole alphabet, but only a subset. And you also want to enumerate and not produce duplicates. So that's actually pretty cool. You can compute intersection and union, optimization and combinations of it. So for instance, bioinformatics, we often wanted to have the intersection of all optimal models. This can all be, this is, you just call the solver that way, that works like a charm. So let me not go too much through the architecture. Just in a nutshell, I think Benjamin Kaufmann, who implemented Clasp, said 10% of the code of the ASP solver is a SAT solver. One way to understand it actually is that this additional closed world condition that everybody has to have a proof, you can think of it as just being here another propagator in the end, and you can think of it as an ASP solver if you just look at the core without these other reasoning modes, just as a SAT solver plus a propagator for everything being founded. So it can be looked as a very restricted SMT solver. But there's much more to it. But this was just to summarize it in a very brief. So what didn't I talk about? One thing I like a lot is you can do metaprogramming. So in Gringo, that's the grounder, you can actually reify your program. You take your program and it's grounded, but output as a set of facts. And then you have an encoding that describes an ASP solver again. Right, and you can then modify this or work on this or have different semantics that come out. Again, it's a very nice thing that I always loved about when I started logic programming. You can do metaprogramming. I talked about qualitative and quantitative optimization. You can also do some heuristic programming. So in the language, you can actually write things down a little bit like rules that you say, oh, this atom here, the score of this atom gets multiplied by 5 or by a value that you get from the inside if certain conditions are true. And in planning, for instance, this gives you 2 orders of magnitude. Now, then there is there are now very powerful APIs and in different. So we have APIs in Python, in C, in Rust, C++, of course, in Lua. There's a Prolog thingy, Java thing is being built. So there are lots of APIs meanwhile. And with them, you can do multi-shot solving. So the idea is that you create solver objects. You can even create several ones, right? That you can communicate to these guys. You can delete information, add information, change the configuration on the fly, right? And do pretty cool stuff. And the latest thing we do is we have a new system, Terlingo, where we extend actually ASP with language constructs from linear and dynamic logics to describe dynamic problems, right? But where in linear temporal logic, you have things like always or eventually, and in dynamic logic, you have regular expressions that you can impose on plans. And if you feel playful, just visit our GitHub site, right? GitHub/Potasco. There you find a lot of things, or potasco.org is actually the even better address. Good, so to recap, and I hope this was 5 minutes, the take-home message is, so ASP is a modeling, grounding, solving paradigm. And in this way, so while I would say SAT is only a solving paradigm, I think CP is closer because it's also about modeling. Grounding is perhaps something that is not so much in CP as a single entity, but done implicitly, right? And then you can view ASP as a combination of database, logic programming, knowledge representation, reasoning, and satisfiability techniques. And again, one could view an ASP solver here, rather looking at SMT, but several theory combinations. Good, so these would be the take-home messages. You can find much more at potasco.org. Be our guest. I think you can find a lot of things. We also try to link to other places. And it's fun after all. And I think that's the most important thing. And perhaps something I know that I used it already in some other talks, but I think for me, it's always it's actually quite important because, you know, when I was doing my PhD, this was beginning of the 90s, this book here was lying on my desk, right? Readings in Nomotonic Reasoning, right? And this was, you know, this was so far from imagining that you could have effective systems running. And so I remember, yeah, anyway, so don't go. So anyway, that was more or less was on my desk. And you see here that the penguin, that's where something has been built to make it fly, well, far away. But actually nowadays, we have more or less equipped this little penguin with jet engines. And well, so we let it fly and let's see how we end, where we end up. Okay, that's it. Thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you for the talk. I think this was a nice introduction to ASP. I'm still trying to wrap my head around some concepts. It seems like there are many interesting things. Like for example, stable semantics seems like a somewhat like a robust solution in some sense. So it's really interesting to see how can we also adapt these kinds of techniques in our systems. So I think we have about 5 minutes for questions. So let's see if you have any questions. You just raise your hand. And I think we already have one question in the audience. So maybe you can just unmute yourself. And yeah, that'll be great.
Yes. So thanks for a very nice talk. I've been following, seeing that you have been doing a flat sync front end for your solver. And yep. I was wondering, do you have any experience? How do you feel about flat sync as a modeling language versus ANSYS set program? And have you discovered any good parts, bad parts about either of them that are interesting, just as a way to connect the fields?
Okay, so I have to be a bit more precise. So we have a flat sync pipeline, but it actually, the backend is not an ASP solver. It's an ASP modulo CSP solver.
Okay.
So actually it's the system Clinkon. We love acronyms here. and so this actually combines, it actually is, it's an extension with Klingo with lazy constraint propagation over integer variables over finite domains. Perhaps before I answer your question then completely, it turns actually out that, for instance, the workhorse in our company is also a hybrid system. It's ASP modulo difference constraints. And so, whenever we go into real applications in industrial scale, I think 80% we do with hybrid systems nowadays. And this is exactly more or less why we also wanted this flat Zingo pipeline, is just to have access to your marvelous benchmark suits to see actually how we perform on them.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I also noticed that during the talk, there is a lot of, let's say, overlap between like what already the constraint programming community has and what thing that you mentioned. And it'd be really good to see where this, so just like we see lots of concepts, and I would just like to see this intersection like in more detail, like where are the differences here? Because for example, when you mentioned this like modulo difference constraints or modulo something, it's also related in CP in a sense, like we also have these kind of concepts of, we just don't call them modulo something, we call them propagators or something similar.
Yeah.
But we don't surely have certain things like stable semantics or.
Yeah. I think the architecture of our solver is close to the SMT idea in the sense that you have an engine that is highly tuned to very few constraints.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you want to have richer stuff, you have a propagator interface where you can add that.
Mm-hmm.
So that I think at least the traditional CP was always to have these many constraints. I remember this catalog that keeps growing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And growing, which of course makes it somewhat more complex to enhance the systems in the long run, because they are more complex.
Yeah, it'd be great to talk about maybe some other time this in more detail, since. Yeah, like I would say like modern CP solvers, like the hybrid SAT CP, it also resembles it's very similar to an SMT solver too.
Hmm.
So there's like lots of intersection, I think, that might be interesting to explore some other time, not now. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Peter Stuckey had this very nice work with his PhD student Aziz at the time, where he said, what can we steal from ASP and plug it into CP, right? And this was more or less this idea that when you have a variable over the integers, and in ASP it's all about proving things. So the idea is more or less, unless you can prove something, you have, let's say, either the smallest or the largest value. Right, and then you can only get the value that is provable next, where there is a justification in it. And that was actually, I think, a very nice way of taking CP and injecting this idea of that whenever you do an assignment to a variable, there has to be a justification for it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay. So let's see. So we have maybe time for one more question. If we have anybody in the audience. Okay. Well, if we don't have any more questions, I will just ask a quick one. So for example, if you think, what do you think would be the most interesting part of ASP that we could steal from, for example? Well, like if we can choose one thing that we can do, what should we focus on importing?
Yeah, it's again this notion of so one way to view ASP, you can even think of it, and this is now I take it a bit to the extreme.
Mm-hmm.
In ASP, you can think of ASP as just having a single truth value,
mm-hmm.
and an implicit undefined. So you only make things true if you have a proof,
mm-hmm.
and otherwise things stay undefined. And what happens in ASP is this undefined, you give it, you then assign it false. So if this is now an integer variable, if you have an integer variable, and unless you have more or less a way to justify an assignment, this integer variable stays undefined.
Mm-hmm.
And then whenever something is undefined, you can give it a default value.
Mm-hmm.
So this is more or less the mechanics that that we translated from ASP, from the logical, the Boolean ASP into the CSP thingy. And that's actually, I think this mechanism is interesting because it gives you this transitive closure, it gives you a default, it gives you non-monotonicity on integer variables, or actually on numerical variables. It would even work for reals, but don't ask me what comes out of this.
It sounds like also some way to explain the assignment.
Yeah.
So that also might be very interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, so it seems like we're really at 10 o'clock, so this will be the end. So thank you, Thorsten, once again.
Thank you again for having me. It was a great pleasure.
I think we really learned many, many different things, many things to explore. So we'll definitely check out Potasco and...
Yeah, and drop me an email if you have further questions or whatever, right?
Okay
great. I'm a missionary for ASP.
Okay, perfect.
Okay,
great. Okay, so thank you.
Bye.